I'm going to start off, and then we've chopped this presentation up. I'm going to give some general comments, and then my colleagues are going to discuss the initiative we're working on. And I want to say that part of what I'm going to say is motivated by personally by some of what happened to us in 2008 in the US. And that is, you know, many of us worked on affordable housing in low-income communities, and we didn't really focus on what was happening in the labor market with declining wages and wealth, and we didn't pay attention to what was happening in financial markets with huge amounts of speculation, particularly in real estate. And in 2008, the gains of the previous 25 years in affordable housing and low-income communities was wiped out in 1 year. The gains of an entire generation of people working across the United States was wiped out in 1 year. And to me, it kind of pointed to the dangers of really working very narrowly on issues of, you know, housing or risk reduction, but not connecting to the larger, broader social processes that are happening and not really engaging with those and not really connecting our local work to these bigger things. So that's what's motivating what I'm about to say. Christian mentioned yesterday two mega trends in the world, urbanization and climate change. I want to add one more, rising economic inequality. I also want to suggest that our community-based work cannot and should not limit itself to local issues. Climate change, economic inequality, and social conflicts are not just local issues, but they need to be part of our local work and our discourse in communities. We see in cities around the world the physical manifestation of economic inequality in the development of expensive luxury housing side by side with the growth of informal settlements lacking even basic necessities. Both sides of these bifurcated cities are part of the same economic, political, and social processes. On the one hand, the world has never been more wealthy in material terms. Collectively, we humans have the material means to fully eradicate poverty and informal settlements. Technology and science have advanced productivity so much that in rich countries and in rich parts of not so rich countries, the driver of economic growth is not basic human needs so much as the wants or taste of well-off people. To sustain markets under these conditions of plenty, businesses try to get those of us in rich countries to throw away perfectly good clothes or throw away one-year-old iPhones, I think we're up to iPhone 10, so that we can buy new, more fashionable or flashy replacements. Or consumers are sold sneakers from Adidas that cost only $5 to make for $100 or more because they have the name of famous athletes written on them. The economy is also increasingly ideologically driven. Workers in rich countries are led to think, without any evidence being provided, that the best way to protect their future is to seek maximum financial returns on their individual retirement accounts, rather than investing in social initiatives that benefit their communities and families as a whole. Because of this ideological push, we now find that the primary wants expressed by workers in rich countries is exactly the same as those expressed by rich people. They want more money in their individual savings accounts and don't think socially or environmentally. So they put their money in financial firms promising to bring the highest returns on investments, regardless of whether their investments meet human needs or ecological needs, or even whether debtors can realistically pay back high interest rates attached to loans. And I emphasize this because Savings from workers' pension funds are one of the biggest sources for real estate speculation and for economic development generally in the world. The flip side of advanced industrialization is that machines are used more and more and workers are needed less. Unemployment is high and workers have less money to spend on their needs. Racism and xenophobia are increasingly used by well-financed, unscrupulous politicians to encourage European and American white voters to blame immigrants or black people for economic stagnation. We see this happening across Europe and, of course, in the United States. The proliferation of repugnant spectacles of conspicuous consumption and mountains of waste on one side of cities and unnecessary poverty and urban squalor on the other side requires, in my view, a two-pronged strategy. One is to connect the wants of relatively rich people to the needs of poor people. This calls for an ideological assault of our own. The German Advisory Council on Global Change calls for a, quote, normative urban compass, end quote, for values and goals. And they list specific measures for achieving such goals. I think this is a very good start, and I will make sure to forward it to President Trump. That is a joke. This normative compass is needed the most in rich countries, where truthfully speaking, we have largely lost our way. In addition, if we are to be truly inclusive and effective in this current political climate, our normative compass needs to call out racism, xenophobic, anti-immigrant, and anti-Muslim ideologies directly. And there ought to be specific measures developed for fighting these dangerous ideologies, just as we have specific measures for dealing with health or material flows in cities or mobility. Secondly, what poor communities need is not just any kind of financial investment, but financial investment that is intended and structured to meet fundamental human needs in line with our normative compass. Not all of these investments can be profit-making. And if governments do not have enough money to make not-for-profit investments, then we ought to tax rich people so that there is enough money to make needed investments in human well-being. And this will save us expenditures on weapons and maybe save the planet in the longer run. We need to do this not only for moral reasons, although moral reasoning is crucial. And one reason we have seen the rise of white nationalist movements in the US is that we have stopped emphasizing humanities except in elite colleges. We need to address the rising inequality, however, in order to reduce conflicts. We need new approaches to finance in order to generate the resources needed to mitigate environmental risk for those who are most at risk. The other strategy we need is well represented at this conference. We are all working hard to find new and better ways to improve conditions in informal settlements and to help build the capacity of low-income people to participate in democracies and to use democracy to change societies. The project in Colombia aims to connect together these various elements, reducing environmental risk in vulnerable communities while reducing economic inequality and reducing conflicts that arise from economic inequality, and dealing with cultures, especially amongst the wealthy, that valorize money above human and ecological needs. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Thompson, for your introduction. As you say, we are together. The Minister of Environment and Sustainable Development of Colombia with the International Organization for Migration, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, with the purpose of addressing together environmental and socioeconomic vulnerabilities in Colombia, because we think it's the only possibility to guarantee a successful transition to a peaceful country and to generate real economic opportunities for poor communities in Colombia. So I want to start explaining how privileged is Colombia in terms of natural resources. Colombia is the second most biodiverse country around the world. So we are very privileged because we have 53% of our territory covered by natural forests. We have more than 50,000 registered species and 311 different types of continental and marine ecosystems. Only Brazil is more diverse than Colombia in the world. Because it's close to Colombia, you're right. So, but the conservation of this biodiversity that we are conscious is very important for the sustainability of the planet has for us two main challenges. The first one is deforestation. So unfortunately, during the last 10 years in Colombia, the right of deforestation has been a main concern for the government. We create a national strategy to control deforestation and the management of the forest because we know that our main richness is our natural resources. Because our rural communities depends on how we can conserve these natural resources for the development of them. The second big challenge that we have is climate change. In Colombia, we are a very vulnerable country to climate change. Just in 2017, we had more than 1,000 emergencies between January and July of this year. And unfortunately, we have a natural disaster in Mocoa because of a landslide, which caused almost 250 people died in this natural disaster this year. And this affected at least 80,000 families, 36,000 areas in the country. There is an statistic which is very evident about our vulnerability to climate change, and is that 312 municipalities in our countries is in extreme risk of having natural disaster this year. So, and we want to show that in Colombia is overlapping the environmental vulnerability with the socioeconomic vulnerability. The population who live in territories with extreme environmental vulnerability also experience unsatisfied basic needs, such as poverty, lack of basic infrastructure like hospitals, education. So it's definitely important for us in Colombia to approach together environmental and socioeconomic vulnerabilities. In the same way, we have a third factor which has been present in our history for many years, which is violence. As you know, Colombia experienced a long-term armed conflict for more than 50 years. And we are writing now a different part of our history. As many of you know, in 2016, we signed a peace agreement with one of the most powerful guerrilla groups in the world, and we are working in the consolidation of the peace in our country. But we cannot deny that the effects of violence have still impacted our territories. The places where the conflict was stronger also experienced the largest environmental and socioeconomic vulnerability in Colombia. So the environment was also one of the main victims of the conflict. For example, illicit crops, displacement, illicit resources extraction, chemical spill, and urban growth produced for many years deforestation, emissions, erosion, water pollution, and extinction of many species. And we need to work together in our construction of the post-conflict to guarantee that this factor disappears of our territories. That's why we consider it so important to generate and institutionality to allow us to create comprehensive and integral solutions who can handle with the three factors that I described, which are first, environmental vulnerability because of climate change. Second, socioeconomic vulnerability and how to eradicate violence of our territories. So in this objective, we are together today announcing our initiatives of the Center for Studies in Climate Change, Equity, and Sustainable Development in Post-Conflict Colombia. And we know as a government that we cannot do that alone, these big challenges. We are working together with the international cooperation, with the academy, and most importantly, with the local communities, because we know that it's so important to empower local communities with all the measures to adapt the necessary conditions to face climate change, but to generate socioeconomic development in a sustainable way in Colombia. A country which is one of the most biodiverse in the country has huge opportunities in the green economy, but we need to guarantee that we have the correct instrument to provide the communities with these opportunities, and is the only way to consolidate peace in our country. I want to invite my colleague Hugo Tovar from the International Organization for Migration, who will be explaining you how we're gonna work with local communities, and also Juan Camilo, who will explain the activities that we are going to implement with our center. Thank you very much.
Well, good morning again. My name is Hugo Tovar, and I'm the chief of party for the Peace for Inclusion program on the International Migration Organization in Bogota, Colombia. IOM has several programs in Colombia, and one of those programs is the Inclusion for Peace Activity Program. But I want to steal some word from Fernando Zapata, who put it right. He summarized basically what I'm supposed to say to you here. No territory is empty, that's what he said. No hay territorio vacío sin población. And we need to work with the people. That's the essence of our purpose, because you cannot talk about conservation, preservation, protecting the environment without taking in consideration the community, and especially in Colombia, the ethnic community that lives in these territories. We believe that sustainable development is possible, and also protecting the environment is possible only if you work with the community. So briefly, I'm gonna talk about what we're doing in the territory. As you can see in the slide, Colombia has over 32 protected natural areas, and 50% of those belong to the communities, Afro-Colombian and indigenous. In those protected areas, you have 108 indigenous communities, over 40 Afro-Colombian councils, and all of these are protected by our new constitution from 1991. In addition to that, due to the peace agreement that we signed last year, as Angelica was describing, we have over 6,000 demobilized combatants from the FARC guerrillas, and also more than 81,000 families that have been affected by the conflict. If you don't articulate all these communities and all these variables, we cannot talk about improving the environment and protecting all these efforts. And due to the fact that Colombia is privileged to have that diversity, we have the huge responsibility, not only for our communities, but to the entire planet. So the Peace for Inclusion program is mainly geared to improve the social and economical condition of Afro-Colombian and indigenous community in 22 municipalities and 10 states. It means that we are already on the ground working with the community. We are working with the organization. We are working with the people. And how are we doing that? We're doing that through four different strategies. First, community and institutional strengthening. Colombia, like Angelica mentioned, in the past 50 or 60 years, has been facing an internal conflict. It means that most of the organization, and even the government, has been developing policies and implementing initiatives during the war, during this internal conflict. Now we need to switch. We need to prepare for the post-conflict to the new context of Colombia. And that's where we are working with the indigenous and Afro-Colombian community to make sure that the organizations are equipped, are capable to take advantage of this new agreement that we have. Secondly, economic opportunities. Because if the communities are in these areas and they don't have access to basic needs, Angelica said, and they don't have jobs, they don't have a way to send their kids to have access to higher education, it's difficult to protect the environment and basically die of hunger. You need to be able to overcome those basic needs, and that's when we come with economic opportunity, creating new jobs, creating new or developing new entrepreneurship initiatives with all the potential that the communities has on the territory. Thirdly, heritage and cultural diversity. Protecting the environment in most of these communities is a cultural practice. And as Fernando was saying, we need to learn from them also to articulate initiative. We cannot just come with an external approach, avoiding what they have been doing historically for many years, which is protecting the environment. And finally, humanitarian assistance. We need to be able to respond to those emergencies like Mocoa and other ones that were being presented here by Fernando and Angelica that takes place in Colombia. Only from January to July, over 1,000 emergencies we face in Colombia this year, over 1,000. So that's where we are working with the government. This program is a 4-year program financed by USAID. We're glad to be part of this initiative with the Ministry of Environment and with MIT, and we hope that with this articulation between academic, international cooperation, and the government, we can have a great impact in the community. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Juan Camilo Osorio. I am a doctoral student in the Department of Urban Studies and Planning at MIT, and I'm part of the team that has been supporting our colleagues at the Ministry and at the International Office of Migration. Angelica and Hugo kindly invited me to walk you through the final slides of the presentation, which basically outline the vision that we've designed to essentially bring together these national goals, the challenges and opportunities that have been identified, the work that the International Office of Migration is doing on the ground with some technical assistance to bring all this together. The proposed center, Center for Studies on Climate Change, Equity, and Sustainable Development in Post-Conflict Colombia, is basically a systematic initiative to, number one, identify where and what are the most successful strategies, ongoing efforts, starting in Colombia. Thank you, Fernando, thanks for your presentation. That was really inspiring. But also abroad, to identify where have local communities been balancing efforts to reduce their environmental vulnerability while improving their livelihoods, guaranteeing that there's an equitable approach to doing this. And together, how can we create a mechanism to support those initiatives, reflect on what's working, what's not working, and improve that going forward? Second, what are the mechanisms to increase the local capacity, both locally and regionally within government, but also outside in civil society, to design, manage, and fully implement proposals, including complete fundraising for initiatives, both with national and international resources, to make sure that these initiatives can go and be fully implemented all the way through? And then finally, what are the financial and technical resources that can inform these processes, strengthen the capacity of these projects to access everything that is required, and create a model that can be replicated in other parts of the country? So thematically, the center and everything that we've developed so far is heavily anchored in the work that our colleagues are doing in Colombia. Specifically, through the work of three of the most relevant departments within the ministry that basically map out to these three bubbles. First, in terms of climate change mitigation and adaptation. Second, in terms of ecosystem protection, natural resource management. And in terms of inclusionary planning and disaster risk reduction. The idea here is to begin working comprehensively and literally really stop thinking in silos and think how to connect both national goals with local priorities, but also how to make sure that one step in one direction can actually guarantee progress on the other two. So in terms of climate change mitigation and adaptation, Some of the activities that are already in motion include identifying mechanisms to use digital and analog technologies to increase the engagement of local communities in the processes of both designing indicators that make sense at the local level. So again, how do we take nationally defined indicators to measure climate change and deforestation and gather information on the ground to determine whether progress really means progress and where are the obstacles and the opportunities that need to be factored in? How do we engage local communities in the process of gathering the data, analyzing that data, and maintaining that data? But at the same time, what are the types of programs that can actually pay these communities for these types of goods and services? On the twin track, as part of climate change and mitigation and adaptation, we're also thinking about what are the best strategies to improve infrastructure systems in communities lacking these basic services, both in terms of energy, generation and distribution, sustainable mobility, et cetera. What are the mechanisms to make sure that these basic needs can be addressed, while at the same time, for example, reducing carbon emissions, you name it. In terms of ecosystem protection and natural resource management, one way of summarizing the objective is to identify what is the most effective opportunity to convert and substitute highly extractive economies for sustainable practices. So one of the main targets that we're planning for here is the creation of a sustainable portfolio that can guarantee opportunities for communities that live in and around protected areas whose livelihoods are changing and that can be adapted to both protect the environment while generating local sources of income. But at the same time, kind of like building on what I said in the previous slide, what are the mechanisms to build on, for example, really important recent successes of the Colombian government in approving a regulatory framework for payment for environmental services, to think about what would it look like to create a system where communities can be paid for providing services regarding monitoring climate change impacts, et cetera. And then finally, in terms of inclusionary land use planning and disaster risk reduction, the idea here is to create a systematic mechanism to really strengthen the capacity of local government and local community-based organizations to access the required technical and financial resources for planning, but also to make sure that there's a systematic and legally binding framework to guarantee that there's an equitable process that can be enforced, but that most importantly can be inclusive and that can guarantee progress overall. The final two slides talk about what are the next steps. So as part of this effort, we've decided that we will be carrying out three demonstration projects. The first demonstration project will be Mocoa, which is the city that both my colleagues Hugo and Angelica mentioned, 36,000 population community that was recently affected by a landslide, as Angelica mentioned. And the second will be a municipality in the Pacific region. It is yet to be determined. This is one of the most vulnerable regions in the country. It presents the lowest levels of income, the highest levels of vulnerability in terms of potential climate change impacts, as well as some of the lowest rates of access to public health and basic infrastructure. The third one is to be determined. We're, as part of the project, defining a methodology to systematically identify how to prioritize future interventions. And literally, just to wrap up, we're currently working in a pre-planning phase that we're hoping will end at the end of the year with a meeting in Colombia and a visit to some of these communities to fact-check some of the observations that have been discussed so far, and most importantly, get to continue meeting with some of the local stakeholders, both in Bogota and in this particular case in Mocoa, to literally begin working on a two-year timeline that we hope to be discussing with you again in the next opportunity. With that, I'll wrap up and really welcome any questions, comments, so that we can build during the discussion. Thank you.